As you know, my name is Herb Seurth. I served with the 101st Airborne Division during World War II, and through a very, let's say, odd set of circumstances, a guy by the name of Stephen Ambrose happened to write a book, and a couple guys by the name of Spielberg and Hanks decided to make a movie, and it made us the rock stars of World War II, which we apologize for. And why I say that, and I really mean it, is because there were so many other fine units like ours that fought, and as many died in their units as died in ours. We lost 52 in about 200 days of combat. That was out of a cadre of 140, so. And I think we had about 220 go through the company, and 140 is the regular cadre of a company. So gives you an idea of what the casualty rates were. And so some guys like myself, unfortunately, came into the company very late in the war. I was assigned to E Company and into the combat area in December, or late November of 1944. Okay, I'm a Chicago kid, born and raised there. I had an all-Catholic education from grammar school all the way through high school, with an interlude of 2 years in a public school, because my mom and dad didn't think they could quite afford the $12.50 a month tuition to go to a place called DePaul Academy, which was assigned to, it was actually associated with the university. But the last 2 years I did attend DePaul Academy and graduated from there. And we had an all-male teaching body. They were all ex-missionaries from China, home from 10 and 20 years of assignment in China. So let me tell you, it was one tough bunch of Vincentian priests that took care of us. We didn't step out of line, or physical punishment was the reward. All right, because of the short time, I'm going to skip over a lot of things that I would normally talk about. We had probably 2 hours or two and a half. I enlisted in the Army at the age of 18 years and 1 month. And right after my first semester in college, I actually enlisted just before I finished my first semester. Wasn't doing well. I was in engineering at Marquette University. And I decided that whatever it was, I didn't have my mind on it, and I enlisted in the enlisted reserve corps before I quit school. And then as soon as I quit school, I was notified that I was going to be called up, which I did. I had volunteered for the Corps of Engineers because I was going to be a mechanical engineer, which I do have a degree in mechanical engineering today. And I urge any of you that have to do your military assignments and so forth to keep your eye on the ball and go out there and get that degree or advanced degree or whatever it is, because they can't take your education away from you. And my education as a mechanical engineer has served me well and provided my family of 9 children and 15 grandchildren with a very, very good income. All right. I was in the States for, about almost 2 years before I went overseas. And I'll just recount a couple incidents that I think you'll appreciate. I was born and raised in Chicago, as I mentioned, and was aware of ethnic populations in certain parts of the city of Chicago, but really didn't live in that area and never experienced any number of different exposures. One day, I was heading for Washington, D.C. in a bus, and I got into the bus, and it was at Fort Belvoir, Virginia. Now, Fort Belvoir, Virginia was below the Jim Crow line, which meant everything was segregated in those days. And I got in the bus, and it was totally empty in the front. And I looked in the back, and it was solid with people. The only trouble was they were all black, and I was white. And it was the first revolution, a revelation that I ever had of what a segregated society was in those days. Thank God that's all behind us. It's so important that it is. But I just thought you might, and I remember we crossed the line into Washington, D.C., which had no segregation policy. And all of the people of color came to the front of the bus, and I was the only white guy there. And it's absolutely scared the heck out of me. I had never experienced anything that in my life. Well, that was early on in my stages of being in the Army, and I sort of quickly learned. I'm going to fast forward. I had some good assignments. I spent 3 months in downtown New York City, going to a school in New York, an electrician school, and was finally assigned overseas. And one day, when I was in England with another buddy of mine, until that time we had been together through the electrician school and basic training and a few things, and we were sitting drinking beer, hot beer, that's the way they serve it in England, and we were talking, and Ellie Chase, his name was, and he came through the war, and we remained friendly for some years after. But anyhow, we were talking, and he said, you know, Herb, he said, we got to get out of this outfit we're in. He said, all these guys are a lot older than we are, and they are going to try, and they're trying to figure out ways of getting out of combat. And Ellie was 19 at the time, I was 19, and he said, I see a opportunity to sign up for the 101st Airborne Division. And I said, well, gee whiz, Elliot, what do we have to do? He said, well, we got to go through parachute training and all that. So we went down, signed up, and have any of you ever made a free fall parachute jump? No one has tried it. Okay, well, not at those days, neither had Ellie or I. And I'll say that one of the interesting things, and it's probably the most violent thing you can ever do without a head-on crash in an automobile, because as you think about it, you come out of the plane at 100 or 110 miles an hour, and your chute opens, and it tries to stop you in the middle of the air. And so when it shows, you are just jerked, and you have your all bundled up, and you got equipment, a rifle, grenades, all kinds of equipment on you. And your arms go flying, and sometimes the equipment gets ripped off. And then you settle down, and it's beautiful, absolutely beautiful. Not a sound. The planes are gone, and all you're doing, and all these guys are floating down through the air and yelling at you. And then in my first, second, third, I don't know, one of my first jumps, I only made 7 jumps totally, none of them in combat. And I heard someone yelling, slip away, slip away. And what that meant was that I was in someone else's way. And sure enough, here was a guy walking on top of my parachute. And that's not very good for either one, because my chute was taking air from his chute, and he was collapsing my chute, so we could both end up on the ground going 100 miles an hour, which isn't very pleasant to have happen. I'll skip all that. We got through parachute school. I was assigned to, we were already in, and that was one of the things that attracted us, was that we could be assigned directly to a division and a company within that division. Up until that time, we were nothing. We floated. We were replacements, and we could go anywhere and dig ditches or build a barracks or deactivate landmines, which the Corps of Engineers did, and that was not one thing that Ellie and I appreciated doing. And I used to kid, they say, well, if you ever make a mistake, just keep your head right over what you're deactivating, because you'll never, you won't have to spend any time in the hospital. So it'd blow your head off. So anyhow, that, we avoided that, got into the airborne, and I was assigned, of all companies, it was just an ordinary company, had never had any publicity or anything else, and it was E Company, the 506 101st Airborne Division. And 3 weeks after I was assigned to E Company, and I might mention to you, and if some of you read in the paper here in about a month ago, there was a seminar on the Jewish community put on a seminar about the Holocaust, and my platoon leader, a guy by the name Ed Chames, who is still, and I know this is hard for many of you to believe, he's the same age I am, 88. He reports for duty every morning at Fort Meade as we speak. He is on the Defense Intelligence Agency, he's a bird colonel, and has been relisted in the Army years ago, and as I say, he's 88, probably the oldest serving colonel in the United States Army. He was my platoon leader. A Jewish guy that practices his faith even today, and that's what led him to our community here a month ago, when he was the first guy in our division to be in, not our division, in our regiment that got into Dachau, and he was sent there by our colonel, who didn't believe the reports that were coming back about guy saying, we're running across boxcar loads of dead corpses laying all over the ground, piles of bodies all over. And the colonel that ran the 506 regiment, Colonel Sink, didn't believe what he was hearing. Couldn't believe that there were reports like that coming back. So he sent Ed up there. And as a result, Ed was the first a guy from our regiment to get into that Dachau. And Ed and I have remained close friends ever since World War II. I talked to him a couple nights ago, and I talked to him probably every week or two at least. And as he said to me one time here about a couple months ago, he said, Herb, I still smell that camp every night when I go to bed, because it was so horrendous. He couldn't believe it. He still has problems with that. And that was what brought him, and I don't know if any of you happened to read that article, but Ed was here a month ago as one of the primary speakers for the Jewish community marking of a Holocaust seminar here. It was given at the Capitol. All right, I'm off of that, but I think it's a very important thing to remember what happened and why we really fought World War II. And that brings me to a sort of a sidebar. We had no idea as a combat infantryman that those death camps existed. No one had ever said anything to us. Politically, it had never been mentioned. And now as they examine what happened during World War II, and how, you know, the let's say the papers managed that kind of information. Our president at that time, President Roosevelt, didn't want to make point of it because he thought that there would be tremendous prejudice by the American public because we were using as an excuse, as part of the reason we were in World War II, to get those, enter those camps and free those people because they were primarily Hebrews from, or Jews from all over Europe that Hitler had incarcerated. Enough of that. All right, I remember going into my platoon that first morning, and of course I was a snappy paratrooper with sharp boots and had seven jumps behind me and all that, and I can remember reporting, and I say, Herbert J. Seurth, Jr., reporting for duty, sir. And Colonel Shames, he was then a second lieutenant, looked at me and says, "I'll take you." So that was how I ended up in E-Company. Little did I know that years later, Stephen Ambrose would write a book about us, and all these incidents. Why I stand here today is because of sort of accidental kind of meetings and talking and so forth. Stephen Ambrose, the author, was a family friend of the Gordon family, and he wintered down in Pas Christi, Louisiana. He was a teacher at New Orleans University in history. He was a history teacher. And the Gordon family, Walter Gordon was a guy in my, not only in my platoon, but in my squad. He was a machine gunner. And I knew him as well as you could know anybody in a short period of time. And their family and the Stephen Ambrose family happened to be friendly. And one day Stephen was talking at a Sunday afternoon dinner or something, outing between them at Pas Christi. Ambrose said something casually like, "Hey, I'm gonna write a book on D-Day." And Walter said, "Well, where are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? Who are you gonna get the people?" And he said, "Well, the 101st is having a reunion in New Orleans, and I'm gonna go down there." And Gordon said, "Well, why don't you come to our company? We're gonna be here, and there'll be probably 20 or 25 of the guys who made D-Day and jumped into Normandy will be there." That's how the whole thing started. And that's how the book got written, then the movie got made. Some of the guys were asked to consult with, have any of you seen the movie Saving Private Ryan? It's getting to be it's a pretty old movie now. Okay, yeah, well a number of our people were consultants on that movie. And as you know, Hanks played in that movie. And that's when all of this started. Our company commander, a guy by the name of Dick Winters. And if you ever get to Normandy at Utah, not Omaha, but Utah Beach, which is the second beach, there's a statue of Dick Winters on the beach there and he was our company commander, very revered guy, a tremendous leader, and lived through, he was only passed away about 2 years ago. So he was the leader of E Company and very respected, and everybody loved him as a combat officer. I'll skip a little bit here, because I had a great time in the Army in the first 2 years that I was in Lancaster. Stationed in downtown New York City, met a Conover model and dated her for all the time I was in New York, which was almost 3 months. And believe it or not, when I came back and I was a stretcher patient on the Queen Mary, the first civilian gal that came on that boat was Pearl Dufour, was my girlfriend from New York, New York model. Wow. I was living. She was on the front of a couple magazines and so forth, and everyone was hooting and hollering as she came in. I was flat on my back with plaster casts from my ribs all the way down both legs. So I was pretty incapacitated, but I rode over on the Queen Mary and came back first class on the Queen Elizabeth. So hey, you can't ask for much better than that in the Army. So, all right. My only combat was, I think it was 23 days or 25 days or something like that. But I was just assigned to the company, and about 2.5 or 3 weeks later on a miserable Sunday night, it had been snowing and raining and sleeting, and we were in an area near Reims, France. And I don't know, some of you may know it because there's a very, very famous Catholic church there with a beautiful, beautiful big stained glass that's well noted as one of the artworks of Europe. And I planned on going to Midnight Mass at Reims Cathedral and had my pass. They said, my company commander, our sergeant had said, okay, you can, everybody wanted to go to Paris. And I said, nah, I think I'll, I didn't have a chance to go to Paris because the other guys had so much more combat time than I did, but I asked for a pass to go to Reims Cathedral. And they said, sure, you can get that, but I never got there. A little interruption called the Battle of the Bulge. I was assigned a division or in a company for a couple weeks. One night they came in and they said, we're going up. And I didn't know what that meant, but everybody else that was combat wise knew. That meant we were being committed to the line and going to be in, going into combat again. There was a real scramble because no one knew where we were going. And it was winter. It was winter by that time. It was the 1st of December. And that general part of Europe, northern part of Europe, has not quite as severe as we have here in Minnesota, but it happened that year was the worst winter that they had in 100 years. So we went into a place called Bastogne. And I think if any of you have seen the HBO series, one of the actors said, well, we're going to make this place famous. Well, I guess we did. Because we were one division, and that's about 10,000 paratroopers. And there were 10 German divisions around us when they surrounded us totally. Tanks all around us, everything. And they kept asking for our surrender. And we were afraid because of the serious nature of what our tactical, not tactical, but our supply conditions were. Many of the guys didn't have winter clothes. By now we had, when we got up to Bastogne, it was snowing, raining, sleeting. Within 2 days, we probably had a foot of snow. In general, we were walking in a foot and a half of snow. Temperatures got down to 20 below zero a couple of nights. We had, many of the guys did not have really good winter clothing. I had come from England and had a little better than a lot of them. And one of the things that I had when they said we were going into combat, I knew where the combat lines were. And they were in northern, up in Belgium and close to the German border and in Holland. And they got winter just about like we do. And the Ardennes is almost the Ardennes forest, which we didn't know at the time, but it was it's almost like our North Woods, solid pine trees, a lot of pine plantations and things like that. So we went into, got in trucks, and we, you know, this might, for 18 hours, we had a couple breaks, get off the truck, but there was no place to sit down. We were and I'm sure most of you know what a grain truck looks like. Okay, that's what we had. And they loaded a platoon, which was basically, I think it was maybe more than one platoon, into that truck with all of the equipment and everything. And there was no place to do anything but stand. So other than getting out about every 5 or 6 hours, we stood in those trucks in a sleet, snow, rain, fog. It was absolutely terrible. And that's why the Germans had picked that time to strike up in the northern part of Europe with a full army. And one special unit went in with, a German unit, went in with 1,000 tanks and 5,000 men. That was just one reinforced regiment. And that was a lot of armor, particularly up in that area, because the armor could not, they were only let's say, limited to the roads. And even then, that was not good. So, but they never broke through our line. We were surrounded until after Christmas Day. And I'll cover some things there about how difficult it was to, you had to change your socks. A lot of the guys didn't have rubbers or galoshes. No footwear other than their jump boots. Well, leather boots walking around in the snow are wet within a couple hours. Well, if you didn't change your socks a couple times a day, by the end of the day, you were well on your way to frostbite and trench foot. And many guys lost half of their toes, all their toes, half of their feet from frostbite. It was really one of the worst things we had, other than if you got wounded and couldn't take care of yourself or someone couldn't move you, you froze to death because the temperatures were below zero a lot. We had some nights where it was 20 below zero, and we were not equipped for the Arctic or any real place like that. What we had was our normal uniforms that we wore. Some had heavier jackets. I had sewed a couple blankets around my sleeping bag because when they said we were going up, we had a little time. We had probably from about 9 o'clock at night until 6 o'clock the following morning to get ready. So I had sewed a couple blankets around my sleeping bag because I knew where the battle lines were in that time, and they were in the northern part of Europe, right around the German borders. Living in the outside, we never, in fact, from the day we left Marmelon-le-Grand, which is right outside of Reims, until my company was relieved about 35 or 40 days later, no one in the company had ever been inside of a barn, a doghouse, a pig pen, you name it. We were outside the whole time. Couldn't build a fire, because if you built a fire, the shells would come in immediately. We were in a perimeter of about 3 clicks, 3 kilometers, and we were surrounded by 10 German divisions. And if you had a serious wound, unless someone got to you, you froze to death. And a lot of that's what happened to a lot of guys. Luckily, when I was wounded, I had medical attention right away because by that time Patton had broken through to us. And a lot of people say, did you ever see Patton? I said, well, I think I saw him once. And that was right after they broke through. And there was a little town, and some of you, I'm sure, in your travels will do some battlefield tours, things like that. And outside of Bastogne was a little tiny hamlet called Foy. And the American line was in that general area. And I saw General Patton riding, and I don't know if you ever seen pictures of him or when he was. And of course, he was a real famous guy. And if there was anyone who contributed to the end of World War II, it was Patton and his tanks. So because he was very audacious with his maneuvering and so forth, and Brooke didn't pull back. And as they said, you know, they used to say Patton is blood and guts, and the guys in the army used to say, yeah, his guts and our blood. So, you know, but he was well respected. But without him, I might not be standing here, because a little later on, I was seriously wounded. And unless I had gotten good medical attention, I probably would have lost both my legs. Now, how did that happen? If you don't smoke, don't smoke. Don't ever start smoking. Because I saw habitually people light cigarettes because they had to have a cigarette. And they were on the lines. They were in the front lines where a cigarette lit in a foxhole was like a 10,000 power candlelight, a searchlight. Just in the dark woods, it was, you know, bring in mortar fire, shell fire, made. And that's how I got hit. I had gone to an aid station to get some stretchers to pick up some, unfortunately, pieces and parts of another two guys that had had a direct hit from a mortar shell in their foxhole. And, you know, it was, usually they try to get those people that had been blown apart and so forth out of the, so the guys didn't have to deal with that, because it was, you know, pretty horrible, and that was combat, and direct hits by large shells really caused havoc. In fact, that's, and I'll get to this, I was at the aid station getting stretchers for a couple other guys who had been wounded, and right behind us on a little hill, probably not more than 10 feet above where the aid station was a new tank unit that had just moved in. They had gotten off the boats from England in Antwerp and come right up to the line. And they were going to reinforce us the next day on an attack on Foy, this little hamlet that was near our main line of resistance. And someone lit a cigarette up on that tank, and within seconds, bam, 88 came in. Now, what's an 88? It's a German shell that's about that big around, roughly about 88 millimeter. We had 75 millimeters, theirs were 88. And they had a trajectory of a deer rifle. So they'd fire flat trajectory at someone. They could barrel aim someone going across the field 1,000 yards, and they'd shoot an artillery piece at one guy. And believe me, when they hit, there was nothing left. You know, they were just blown apart. So within seconds, that 88 came in. It landed, I think it hit on the back of the hill just behind where we were standing. It killed four of the guys that I was talking to, and I was the only one who came through it. And I was laying there, and I laid there, and if we were not in 2 feet of snow when I was hit, I would have died right on the spot. And luckily I didn't, a shell fragment went through both my femurs, shattered them, absolutely shattered them. In fact, if you look up here, you'll see a chunk of my femur that's with the Purple Heart. The doctors had to come to my bed well after I was in skeletal traction. Has anyone ever been in skeletal traction from an automobile accident, football accident, anything like that? Well, what it is, I had two shattered femurs. That's your main bone. It had missed my femoral arteries in both cases. If it had nicked one of the femoral arteries, I wouldn't be standing here, I'd be dead. So they had to put me in skeletal traction. Well, that meant that they drilled holes through my knees and put a little wire. And then that wire had a big U clamp on it. And then at the end of that wire was an attachment and had weights on the end of the bed that kept my femurs in place. Because otherwise, remember, your femur is your biggest bone in your body. And we were paratroopers. Our legs were tremendous. We run and jumped and done all that, and we had tremendous leg muscles. Well, those leg muscles are trying to pull the bones together. So unless they weight enough to get those bones, get those muscles tired, the bones will never grow back together. So I had skeletal traction on both my legs. And if I often, when as I had to, I do visit hospitals now and talk to the guys that get wounded over in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Iran. And I say to the doctors, you know, if you have any trouble getting any of these Al-Qaeda or guys that don't want to talk, I suggest put them in skeletal traction. and they'll tell you anything you want to know within 24 hours. Because what they do is they drill a hole. This is for treatment now, remember. Drill a hole through your knees, the joints of your knees. Then they put a little U-shaped thing on there, and then they put weights on all that so these femurs can set. And as you'll see down here, if you have a minute, there's a chunk of my femur bone laying there, which they were going to throw away, and I said, ah, no, I had gotten my Purple Heart a couple of days earlier. And they said, let me keep that. So that the chunk of my femur bone and the Purple Heart are there together. I probably won't have much time to do that. How am I doing on time here?
You have about 10 minutes till questions.
10 minutes, that's all. Woo. Okay. Well, I think I explained to you how I got wounded and that, but I don't think that I can emphasize enough that, and I'm not a crusader, don't get me wrong. I have never had an honest-to-God puff on a cigarette in my life. Don't ask me why. I never wanted to smoke. My mother and dad smoked. Dad smoked cigars and pipes, my mother smoked cigarettes, and they used to say to me, I was an only child, by the way, and they used to say to me, well, now, if you're going to smoke, this is in high school, if you're going to smoke, don't smoke behind our back. Don't go out in the alley or the garage. Just smoke here with us. I said, no, I don't want to smoke. Well, I was really glad I did, and there was one real advantage, very much, because cigarettes were always pretty scarce, and the guys would chain smoke and all this, you know, steady their nerves. I don't know what that was all about, but they seemed to help. And we had K rations. That was a meal that came in a box like a Cracker Jack, and just about that size, and was all wax coated and so forth. And in there were a chocolate bar. We got nice chocolate bars three times a day on those things because they were intended to be minimal rations for people in combat. So I used to save the chocolate bars, and guys want my cigarettes because there were also cigarettes in those. There were about three cigarettes in each K ration, which meant you know, maybe 9 to 12 cigarettes a day that you were allocated light and not smoking. So when I got hit, I had chocolate bars in my combat jacket filled with chocolate bars. So, but it cost them my one little package of cigarettes. It cost them their whole day ration of chocolate bars because I didn't care if I smoked or not, and they didn't. Laughed about that, so I remember that my combat jacket was filled with chocolate bars. All right, a couple things that remain with me. I buried a 16-year-old Kraut. We call them Krauts. Germans, but I'm German. Had an umlaut on my name during my grandfather's time. He took it off during World War I. But anyhow, I digressed and I lost my train of thought here. What did I just say there? You recall? Kath?
16-year-old.
Yeah. Oh, the meal and the K rations and so forth. So I did very well. And when I got hit, as I said, I had pockets full of chocolate bars. Now, one of the things that we were concerned with was, until Patton broke through to us, we were surrounded for 10 days by 10 German divisions. We were one division with one tank, small tank unit. But we were in a tight perimeter. We had had chance to dig in. They were fairly good defensive positions. And when they attacked us, we had the advantage because we were in the foxholes at permanent machine gun positions and so forth. And I would say that we were only close to being overrun one time. Christmas Eve, they attacked us with a whole company on our platoon front. When the battle was over, there were 28 German dead. We had had one, we were, one guy wounded, that was Walter Gordon, who was in my squad. And it was the woods were filled with, the snow was covered with blood, and there were 28 Germans dead, and we have no idea how many were wounded. But if you look up here, and you won't, there's a little Wehrmacht, that's the German army insignia that they wore on their left breast. That came off of a 16-year-old dead Krupp. And, you know, he was 16. Well, I don't know if he was actually, but he looked like he was 16. Blonde hair, blue-eyed. And I buried him on Christmas Day. Quick story, and I know I'm running out of time, but I think you might appreciate this. The fact that I buried him, and that was a job. He had to dig through, remember, this had been below zero around there for days. He had to go through like about 18 inches of frost to get to ground. So I don't think it would be gotten down more than about 2 feet at all. And forget him and cover him up. It always bothered me that I had buried him and we hadn't marked a grave. Well, I had a friend of mine who lived in Bastogne, had a museum there for a number of years, he doesn't anymore. And he just mentioned to me, he says, hey, he said, you know, they're foresting the Beaujac Woods, because the Beaujac Woods was pine plantations. The pines were all in rows, and you'll see them here in the United States, but that's very typical of what they were doing. And they were foresting that area. And I said to Marco, he's a Dutch, ex-Dutch army officer, I said, Marco, that kid that I buried is right there in that area that is now, we're talking about 2 years ago, and that was 66 years ago that I buried him. And he got a hold of the forestry people and he told them about where the grave, and sure enough they found a grave. And so he was disinterred and buried in the German cemetery, properly marked with his dog tags and so forth. But that was about 64 years after he had been buried. So there wasn't, and actually there wasn't much left of him. But it did bother me because the only thing that I thought of was, you know, if I had been killed and was buried someplace, and my mother and dad never knew anything about what happened to me other than I was in a battle and never came back, and all that, I wasn't having combat fatigue or anything. It was just bothered my conscience. I guess maybe like when I maybe stole a candy bar out of my mother's and dad's supply or something as a kid. But it was relieving to me to know that that young man who was about 16, who didn't plan on dying, died on Christmas Eve, and they reburied him and he was properly marked. One other thing, we were strafed two times by American airplanes. No German planes, just American. Once they dropped a 500-pound bomb, doggone hit our company CP, all our officers were there. Had they hit it, they would have wiped out every officer in our company. The next day they came over and they strafed. Someone was at the little well that we were at, not well, but a spring. And one of the guys got hit with a 50 caliber round, which is big, going right through his helmet, and his brains fell into our water supply. Because we had this lovely spring coming out of the side of a farm field. So when I got there, they had taken away the guy, and his helmet was laying there with the hole in it. And I'm looking and I'm seeing, wow, there were his brains in our water supply. Because we didn't, you can imagine, the temperatures are, you know, 0, 20 above, 10 in that area. Harder than heck to keep water in your canteen or anything. So I had never mentioned this thing to anyone. I cleaned out the spring with my rifle butt. I cleaned it out as best I could and got our water for the day and went back. Never told anyone. 20 some years later, I was sitting talking to a guy by the name of Pappy King, who was in my squad, lived in down in Peoria where I was working at the time. And I mentioned that to him, and he looked at me and he said, "Junior," that was my nickname in the outfit, "Junior, you didn't do a very good job." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "When I came to get more water that day," he said, "I still had to clean up the spring." So that was, we laughed about it. We did. We laughed about it. I mean, it was gruesome things, but that's the way it is. Now, I think I'm almost out of time, aren't I?
Does anyone have any questions for Mr. Seurth? Others, I'm sure he has more.
Oh, please ask some questions.
Anything at all?
Want me to pick someone? Oh, there we go.
Highest that you jumped from?
Oh, we started at 1,000 feet. And then our last few jumps were, I think, about 700. So on a good day, if the wind wasn't blowing, that wasn't bad. But remember, when you jump out of the airplane, you're going 110 miles an hour. So you still have a lot of airspeed when you hit the ground. And I heard so many stories of guys and what happened to them, you know, landing in trees and hitting the ground and landing in ditches on the side of a road in 7 feet of water with all this equipment on that they jumped on, had on D-Day, machine guns, mortar shells, mortar base plates, days of food, any clothing that you're, clean socks, underwear, everything else you're wearing. Because if you've ever seen a picture of a paratrooper getting ready for a combat jump, you can hardly see the paratrooper. He's got so much stuff on. I never made an equipment jump because I never made a combat jump. So the guys in my outfit did. They made Normandy and then they made Holland. So, okay. Other questions or? No?
Jeremy?
Yes. You'll have to tell me.
What were you doing when you heard the Germans surrender?
The Germans surrendered, that was May. I had just gotten back from England. I came back in a plaster cast from here, both legs down. And that would have been May 7th. I came back to, I got landed in the States the day President Roosevelt died. And I was in Clinton, Iowa, which was the rehab center that we were at. And that was quite a day. It was, I sure didn't dance around because I was still flat on my back in bed because I hadn't even walked. I never walked for 9 months. Never put my foot on the ground for 9 months. But my physiotherapist had come along every day and he said, "Well, you should do a couple exercises." Well, in the airborne, you did exercises. It was part of your routine and commitment to stay in fit. So I did all kinds of exercises with my legs, never walking, but having lead weights on them when the doctor would say, "Okay, the bones are good enough for that." And the first day out of bed, 9 months after I had been hit, they said, "Okay, you can put your feet down," because they'd x-ray every couple of weeks and check my bones. And I put my feet on the ground, and they said, "Well, okay, you want to stand up?" I said, "Sure, I'll stand up." So they got me some parallel bars on wheels, and I put my arms around there, and I walked across that ward. The first steps I had taken. 2 weeks later, they fitted me with braces on both legs. 2 weeks later, I went home on a 60-day pass. So, but that was sort of determination, and I did. My mother and dad rigged up a sort of a chair when I was at home to scoot around on, so I didn't have to put those braces, because they came up all the way up to your hips, and you were tied into them, and my knees were locked. The only time I could sit down, when I sat down, I had to unlock those braces. And but I can't complain. You know, and I'm a little disabled, but for years I did cross-country skiing, never downhill. But cross-country, I competitive, small boats, raced, and all those things. I had a pretty normal life, and And I have to say, the Army and the government's treated me well with regard to medical supply, medical attention, and so forth. So, okay, a couple other, any other, come on, let's come on.
We have time for one more question, if any of you still have one that you'd like to ask.
Yes.
Do you have, like, any one vivid memory?
What's that?
One vivid memory?
That particularly stands out.
That stands out?
No, you know, I remember, I have a pretty doggone good memory of that time. And I don't really remember anything. I don't have any post-traumatic, if you want to put it that way. I think the biggest thing that bothered me was that 16-year-old kid that I buried and never marked his grave. And I was thinking of it in relationship to what my mother and dad would have gone through, having been an only child, if all they did was get a telegram saying I was killed in action or missing in action and no one knew where I was. So it was conscience. It was conscience. And those are some of the things you learn in an institution of this type. Believe me, thank your lucky stars that your mom and dad have the means to send you to such a fine school. By the way, one of my sons did graduate from here back in the 70s, I don't know, I think 70. So after 9 kids, you sort of lose track of where everybody graduated. Just got to get them through school and pay for it. Which I'm glad to say that almost all my kids have got college degrees and are working in the field. One works for the Indianapolis Colts, another one manages a construction crews and out in the mountains of Colorado. And another one is a director of marketing and of a fairly large company. So they've done well, and don't get every bit of education you can. If you can get a degree with a discipline, do that. You know, engineering is great. You can go anywhere with engineering, except maybe a history teacher.
All right, very quickly, before we thank Mr. Seurth for his time, also make sure if you guys see Jack Tucker that you guys thank him as well, because he hooked us up with Mr. Seurth and gave us this opportunity as well. So thank you so much for taking time.
And I'm sorry we don't have more time, but whatever, that's the way it is. So.